reading this morning is taken from the book of Ezekiel, chapter number 47, beginning to read from verse 1 to verse 12. Ezekiel 47, beginning to read from verse 1 to verse 12. I will read. Then he brought me back to the door of the temple, and there was water flowing from under the threshold of the temple towards the east, for the front of the temple faced east. The water was flowing from under the right side of the temple, south of the altar. He brought me out by way of the north gate and led me around on the outside to the outer gateway that faces east, and there was water running out of the right side. When the man went out to the east with the line in his hand, he measured 1,000 cubits, and he brought me through the waters. The water came up to my ankles. Again he measured 1,000 and brought me through the waters. The water came up to my knees. Again he measured 1,000 and brought me through the water and brought me through. The water came up to my waist. Again he measured 1,000, and it was a river that I could not cross, for the water was too deep, water in which one must swim. A river that could not be crossed. He said to me, "Son of man, have you seen this?" Then he brought me and returned me to the bank of the river. When I returned, there along the bank of the river were very many trees on one side and the other. Then he said to me, "This water flows towards the eastern region, goes down into the valley, and enters the sea. When it reaches the sea, its waters are healed. And it shall be that every living thing that moves, whether the rivers go, wherever the rivers go, I beg your pardon, will live. There will be a very great multitude of fish, because these waters go there. For they will be healed, and everything will live wherever the river goes. It shall be that fishermen will stand by it from En-Gedi to En-Gelaim. There will be places for spreading their nets. Their fish will be of the same kinds as of the fish of the great sea, exceedingly many. But its swamps and marshes will not be healed. They will be given over to salt. Along the bank of the river, on the other side, on this side and that, will grow all kinds of tree used for food. Their leaves will not wither and their fruit will not fail. They will bear fruit every month because their water flows from the sanctuary. Their fruit will be for food, and their leaves for medicine." That's the word of the Lord.
We start to hear the good news of our salvation, as it is recorded in the Gospel of St. John, chapter number 15, and reading from verse number 1. The good news of our salvation, as recorded by St. John, chapter 15, reading from verse number 1. "I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me, and I remain in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing."
Thank you.
want to thank you, Lord, for welcoming us this morning, that we may hear your voice. We pray that God Almighty, you shall speak to each and every one of us in a way that we can be able to understand your word, that you may keep it, that your word may continue to purify us and to make us holy, and to help us to grow in faith from one level of glory to the other. Jehovah, we invite your presence in our midst. Come and use me, O God, to be an instrument of honor before your people, that your word may speak profoundly into our situations and into our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning we read from the book of Ezekiel, Prophet Ezekiel, chapter 47, from verse 1 to 12. And then we read the Gospel of John, chapter number 15, verse 1 to 8. And I want to talk about spiritual maturity, or growing spiritually. Spiritual maturity. This is one main problem with the church of today, because people are not really growing spiritually. It's one of the problems that the church, all the churches all over, all the pastors, wherever you meet with them, are complaining of spiritual immaturity in their churches. And this, the word today really talks about that, how we need to grow spiritually and what we can become when we have grown spiritually. One as a feeling. Yes, what you can become. Like in the book of Ezekiel, it talks about when you get deep and deep and deep and deep and deeper, how you start bearing fruits and all that we are going to eat. Therefore, it's a good topic for us to study this morning. Our theme for this month is worshiping God in spirit and in truth. And we cannot be able to worship God in spirit and in truth unless we mature in our faith. Unless we get deep into our faith, unless we get to know God better than we do, it will be very hard for me and for you and for us as Christians to be able to worship God in spirit and in truth. It's only those that are mature in their faith, that have deepened their love for God, who will be able to worship God in spirit and in truth. One last thing. Spiritual maturity is the spiritual dwarfness, you know, that we find in our Christians. And wherever you go, you live in a community of Christians, or you meet a Christian, you'll be able to identify things that will lead you to concluding that there is some Christian immaturity in this person, or in this group, or in this church. Christian maturity is not about age, because you can be very old, and yet you have refused to grow spiritually. Because there are people who have been in church for many years, 40, 30, even 50, but they have refused to grow spiritually. They are like that advert which says, I'm getting older, but they have refused to do what? To grow old. Spiritual maturity is not a matter of the appearance, how I look, you know, because the look may really cheat, and it can lie. Today, the best thugs are those with the suits and all that, isn't it? And today, even women have become called women, CDO. And you look at them, they are having their handbags, they are having their skirt suits, they are having their makeups. And you cannot imagine that that woman will con you. So the appearance can be cheating, it can cheat. You cannot say really that it is through the appearance that that person is mature spiritually. Spiritual maturity is not a matter of the achievements that I have achieved, the recognitions, the responsibilities that the church has given you, that you have been made an elder, you are leader of the praise and worship team, I am a pastor, you are in this committee or that other committee. It's not a matter of the education
that one has. It's not a matter of the titles people have, but it's that is not what Christian maturity is. Christian maturity is the change of attitude and character. One has a feeling. Change of attitude and character. It is that attitude and that character that makes a difference. And D.L. Moody says, character is what you are in the dark. Character is what God knows about you. It's what God knows about me. One has a feeling. So how is my character this morning? How is my behavior this morning? How do people talk about me? Yes, what do they say about my character and about my behaviors? Today, people have a lot of immature talks. Wherever you go, the word mushene now has become like an international word, isn't it? Mushene, because everywhere is what? Go even to Azeri, mini? Mushene, ndio? Yeah? Has become international, not just a Kikuyu meal. The word wana is not just a Kikuyu name, isn't it? Because there is a lot of wana, a lot of mushende, a lot of those immature talks, a lot of backbiting, yeah, a lot of talking about other people, a lot of those things. And it is good when you are talking about people to let your words go through three gates. The first gate is you ask yourself, what I'm saying, is it true? Is it true? What I'm talking about, Mama so-and-so, is it true? What I'm talking about, Mr. so-and-so, is it true? And number two, is it right? Is it? Is it right? Is it right? It could be true, but is it right for me to talk about these things? Is it right for me to talk about this member of my committee? Is it right? And then the third gate, is it beneficial? Of what value? Will it add any value to him or to her, or even to myself, or even to my listeners, to my audience this morning? Will it add any benefit to them? Is it true? Is it right? And of what benefit? Of what value? What has it given? Those three gates are very, very important, because when you do that, you'll be able to really think and rethink before you would talk about people, before you would talk mushende about other people. One as a theory, we need to grow up. Hallelujah. That is what Christian maturity is. And I have four indicators here, according to our readings for today. Four indicators of Christian maturity, four indicators of growth. And one of them is what we find in the book of Ezekiel. You know, deepening or the deepness of our faith. Deepening our faith. Ezekiel brings a picture, a vision of someone that he saw with a measuring line going down from the temple to the river that was going down. And as he went on measuring, at some point, the water reached the ankle. The water, so it was ankle deep. And then he went down. The water became knee deep. This is in the book of Ezekiel, chapter number 47, verse 3. Knee deep. Then he went on. The water, ikafika the waist, the waistline. What has he given? It went up to the waist. And then he went on, and the water immersed whoever was measuring. It covered him completely. And at that point, when he was covered, the Bible says that this guy, the man of God, Ezekiel, started seeing, you know, a life flowing in that liver. There were fish flowing in that liver. There were plantations and vegetation started coming out. You know, trees started growing. Yes. And later he could even find fruit trees that had even the food that you can eat or were meant for food, and their leaves were for healing. One has a feeling. Because the more you get deeper in God, the more you get deeper in Christ, the more you get deeper in your faith, the more you become fruitful. The more you become productive. The more you become better. The more I become a better priest. The more people will find solace when they come to me. The more people will find healing. The more people find something good from me. But when you are just knee-deep, ankle deep, or you have gone up to waist, or waistline for that matter, then there is no life coming through you. So let us desire, my brothers and sisters, to get deep into our faith, to know God better. Determine this year to know God better. Determine this year to know the Bible better, one as if you will, so that you can be reading it for yourself. You can be quoting it for yourself. You can be able to memorize it for yourself. Determine this year to be prayerful than you have ever been, so that you can get deep into your faith and get to know God better and grow deeper in His love and in His knowledge. Hallelujah. That is what one is expected of us. Are you anybody? Ask your neighbor, are you anybody? Are you needy? Have you gone up to the streets? Or are you like that liver that became uncrossable? It covered everywhere. Hallelujah. And from there we find multitude of fish, fresh water, healing, food, and all that. When you look at the things that are happening around us, do you find people that are deep in their faith? Those of us who are Kikuyus, you know what is happening. And I believe even with other tribes, it is the same. People going back to their traditional religions. Right now, as we speak, in the areas of Kiambu, there are a lot of problems because people are going back to praying, facing what? Mount Kenya, isn't it? Even going around Mount Kenya to pray. Yeah? People are doing those traditions and those things that our forefathers who came to know Christ left many years ago. The other day, we had an evangelist from one of our churches in the diocese. And she's a lady and she's trained, she's a theologian. She went to those traditions and then she went back. And I called her because I know her and I know her work. And I asked her, Virginia, do you really want to go back? Do you mean you want to go back? Are you ready for all those things that are being done there, including the circumcision of women? And I remember I was asking her this in Kikuyu. Akaniambia, I have already now passed that. And this is an evangelist in the church. The other day in Kameme, there was a heated debate because even women are going to Luberi area for circumcision and those other things. People going back, drifting back to where they came from, drifting back, leaving this faith because they have not grown deep into their faith. Desire this morning to grow deeper. What does it give you? If you are up to ankle deep, move a step forward. If you are at knee deep, move a step forward, so that you are able to get deeper and deeper in the knowledge of God. One is given. Number two is the firmness. How is your spiritual stability? How are your spiritual shock absorbers? You know, the firmness of a tree depends with what it eats. And what do you eat as a Christian? Not the food that we eat, but the word of God, the prayers that we pray, the fellowships that we attend, make us become firm in our faith. If you are in the Mothers Union, go for those fellowships. If you are in Kama, you are going to initiate fellowships. If you are in the youth, go for them. You can only grow spiritually by building a firm Christian character. One of Sifiwe. The book of 1 Peter 3 says, be like a well-watered tree. Psalms 1, verse 3. Be like a well-watered tree that is planted by the river. A well-watered tree planted by the river, which when even wind comes, even the storms comes, they cannot be able to move it because it is firm, it is strong, it is well grounded, and therefore it is able to overcome every kind of storm. Why we are not able to overcome storms in our lives? Why we are not able to overcome the challenges that come our way? Why we are tossed from this head to the other head? Why? It is because we are not firm in our faith. Are you firm in your faith? When you are firm in your faith, you are able to say no to all unrighteousness. You are able to say no to all evils. You are able to say no to every kind of evil, false doctrine that would come your way. Why we fail to do that? It is because we are not firm in our faith. This is why we are seeing very good young ladies, when it reaches the time of marriage, you don't even know how they got the marriage. They have been in church. Are you there, young ladies? Hello? This is why we fight, even those young men who are saved and they sing and they praise and all that. When it comes to that, they fall. Why? Because they are not firm in their faith. Tell your neighbor to be firm in his or her faith. Tell them to be firm. Yeah, be well grounded in your faith. So that even when matters of corruption come in that office where you are, you will say, I will not bribe because I am firm in my faith, because I'm a Christian. You will not be moved. Number three is focus. Whether there is rain or not, sun or not, storms or not, a tree focuses or focus is the consistency in growing up. Right? It's just what to grow up. Stay focused on God and His ways will keep us connected to that source of energy. And the source of energy is Jesus Christ. One has a few ways. And in our second reading, the Bible repeats the word, remain in me, remain in my love, for over 10 times in that book of John 15. Remain in me, remain in my love, and I will remain in you. One has a few ways. A lot of emphasis here, and when you see in a text of 12 verses, one word being repeated over 10 times, that tells you there is a lot of emphasis in that word. Remain in me. That is the emphasis. Jesus told his disciples, do you want to become firm? Do you want to grow deep in faith? Then do what? Remain in me. One as if you will. Yes. Remain in Christ. Remain in his love. When you remain in him, the Bible says, then you shall bear much fruit. Hallelujah. And then he says, apart from me, you can do nothing. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Have you ever imagined of that? That apart from him, you can do nothing. You can try to do as many things as you want. But apart from him, anything that is beneficial to the kingdom of God, you are not able to do it. Anything that counts eternally, you are not able to do it. You must remain in him and let him remain in you. Jesus wants to remain in us, but are we allowing him to remain? Are we allowing him to remain in us? Because he wants to remain in me, but I have to make a choice and allow him to remain in me. And by so doing, then I will be able to get focused on him, and I will be able to grow, and I will be able to, you know, to get to know the things of God. I will be able to get to start firm, and to say no to all unrighteousness. And number four, the fruits. And in both of the texts of today, they put a lot of emphasis on the fruits. Because we know that we can only know a good person by their fruits. We can only know a tree by its fruits, isn't it? Yes, by its fruits. That's how you get to know this is a lemon tree or this is a knowledge tree. Because when you look at a knowledge tree, you may not understand whether it's a knowledge tree or whether it's a lemon tree. You can only get to know by the fruit that tree will bear. What kind of fruit do I bear? What kind of fruits do you bear? Christian maturity is all about fruit. Hallelujah. And the Bible says that every grown-up fruit, you know, will bear fruit in due season. Do you bear fruit? Are you bearing fruit? And then what kind of fruits are you bearing this morning as a Christian? What kind of fruits am I bearing this morning as a Christian? You shall know them by the fruits that they bear. If you read Galatians 5 from verse number 16, there the Bible talks about the fruits of the flesh. And down there, again, the Bible talks about the fruits of the Spirit. They are pretty self-explanatory. It's a sermon that you don't need to be preached to. The book of Galatians, chapter number 5, from verse 16. Bonus if you. Do you have your Bible this morning? If you have it, you can go with me there. Galatians 5. We read about the fruits of the flesh and the fruits of the Spirit. So verse number 16 going down says, "So I say, I live by the Spirit, and you not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. For the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They are in contrast, conflict with each other, so that you will not do what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of sinful nature are obvious." These are the fruits of the sinful nature. These are the fruits of the flesh. Number one, sexual immorality. Are you there? Number two, impurity. Number three, debauchery. Number four, number five, witchcraft. Number six, number seven, number eight, number nine, number 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Those are 15, isn't it? Do you find yourself anywhere there? Ask your neighbor, do you find yourself anywhere there? Are you having any one of those? Eh? Maybe you only see those with the sexual immorality as the ones who have those fruits. But even impurity, yeah? Even envy. No, even hatred, which is very common to Christians, is part of the fruits of the flesh. And then clearly, verse number 22 talks about the fruit of the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit, number one is? Number two? Number three? Number four? Five? Six? Seven? Eight? Nine? Ten? Gentleness, 11. You don't have your Bible. You have to understand yourself. Control. Do you find yourself anywhere there? Are you self-controlled? Are you peaceful, a peacemaker? Are you patient with other people? Do you exercise goodness and kindness? Are you faithful to your spouse, to the work, to your boss? Are you gentle? Those are the fruits of the Spirit. And the Bible says, Against such things, there is no law. So, we are supposed to do them and to have them naturally as Christians. They should flow from me naturally. Kindness should flow from me naturally. Patience should come from me naturally, isn't it? Goodness should be in my face every other day. Self-control, I should exercise it all the time. Those are the fruits of the Spirit. Let us bear good fruits that we may glorify our God who is in heaven. Let us be focused. Let us be firm. Let us grow deep in our faith. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.